All right, as you can see, Brother Garrett's coming this way. I'm going to say just a thing or two before he preaches for us this morning. I wanted to thank everybody for something you didn't know you were doing, but you were doing. You know, last year about this time, I was quite sick. And I missed pretty much all of December and a lot of January and didn't get to do much in February. And a lot of people stepped up in many different ways. Not just these men that filled the pulpit, but a lot of people stepped up to do a lot of things. And folks, I don't want to call you out by name because I've been told here in this culture that embarrasses people just way too much. But I want you to know, wow, has God answered a prayer that I prayed some years ago. And my prayer was this: God, please raise up faithful people that can continue the ministry beyond the bounds of just this little group. And folks, we send people to Mayerton, to a church there, on a regular basis. We've had a request to send people to Hennemond to preach in a church there, which we started last month. We have an opportunity now. We're going to India every year. Got a chance to go to, we go to Malawi every year, and little by little, things are just growing. And I want you to know, God has been answering the prayer. People, left and right, are stepping up and taking on responsibilities. And all these announcements I gave you about a youth event and a young couples event, I didn't do any of it. I just asked, would you please help? And these people have just grabbed a hold of that plow. And there's other events and other things that are going to be coming up soon as well. So many people doing so many things. So I wanted you to know, as a church, I sure do appreciate you folks. What a blessing. What an encouragement it is to be your pastor. I really mean that. Now, I will call out these two names just so that you know. We are trying to get more organized and have more events and do things for certain age groups that would be age appropriate, right? Tony Nicolene wanted to come to the youth event and jump on the trampoline. See, we got to do something about that. We got to get organized. In the process of that, I've asked Armand and Garrett. Now, these two guys, I just want you to know, everybody knows that Francois is our deacon, right? You know that? These two gentlemen, I've asked them to step up as student and youth pastors. Now, they're both kind of sharing that. So a student pastor for our university folks, and then the youth pastor as well. And these two guys have done a great job thus far and been a big help. They're not the only ones. They're just the ones I've chosen to embarrass this morning. But so many people gave me the advice, Brother Mike, don't burn yourself out. Don't do too much. Take a break when you need it. I can't tell you how excited I am in just a few seconds here to sit down and get preached at. I can't wait, and I'm looking forward to what God has to say to us this morning. So Brother Garrett, you come on out here and give us the Word of God.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Last time I wanted to use the board, but it didn't work. So this time, I'm adamant that I will use the board. It organizes my thoughts, so I hope it does yours as well. If I don't see it, I cannot understand sometimes. So that's a blessing or a curse, I don't know. All right, so this morning, over the last few weeks, as you know, Pastor Mike has been going through, I would just say, controversial topics in the mornings with us, and I could just say doctrinal differences and important things that we need to know why we stand for what we stand in a society where people don't really know what they stand for anymore. And so throughout these lessons, what Pastor Mike has emphasized, though, is what matters more than knowing where you stand and what your difference is to, or why you feel a certain way about something, is how do you approach that? How do you share that message still in love? So there's a verse that says we need to speak the truth in love. And as I thought about that, I asked myself, what does it mean to speak truth in love? Now, we know that John 17:17 says that sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. So God's word is the truth. So the Bible defines what truth is. And then to do that in love is to do that, according to 1 Corinthians 13, is to do that with kindness and patience and humility and thinking of that person more than you think of yourself. So if I could say that speaking truth in love is sticking to the Bible while at the same time treating people with love and respect. and caring more about their soul than about their doctrine. So too many times as we, as Bible-believing Christians, I think we fall to the side of focusing so much on preaching that truth, or where do I stand on baptism? Where do I stand on tongues? Where do I stand on prophecy? And forget about that heart, that soul of that person. So today I want to speak to you about the symptoms of a loveless knowledge. And so I've titled this sermon, "The Dangers of an Open Bible, but a Closed Heart." I think before we go any further, I'd just like to pray. Lord, I come to you this morning, and I'm just a man here standing with a page with a bunch of writing on, Lord, and I feel so inadequate, Father, but I know that you are more than capable. And Father, our desire is not to be spoken to by another man, Lord, but to hear from you. It's my desire this morning, Father, and I ask that you would please come speak to us, come open our hearts, Lord, to hear your word, and not just sit here with a hard heart, a closed heart, and already having made up our minds about what we're doing after this or what road we're taking, Father, but that we would be standing here, sitting here, and asking, Father, please come open our hearts, and Father, that you would speak to us. Father, we need you and nothing else. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So with this title of "The Dangers of an Open Bible and a Closed Heart," now the open Bible represents, could I say, doctrinal knowledge, right? And the closed heart represents a hardened or a coldness towards God's Word. So God's Word is trying to get to your heart. It's trying to change your life. But it's like there's a shield around your heart that's constantly just stopping this truth from setting in. I always think of it as that when someone preaches or I hear something, it hits my mind and it stays there for a while before it goes to my heart. And sometimes it just gets stuck there and it never gets to your heart, and your heart is where the action comes from. Now Spurgeon illustrated this in one of his quotes that he said, the great bell of Moscow is too large to be hung. The question arises, what was the use of making it? Some people are so studied, they cannot make themselves understood, nor bring their minds down to a level to speak simple gospel truths. Here too, the same question might be asked, what is the use? So what is the use of having a head full of knowledge, but no heart to share the gospel with a dying world? And so, as we go into our first point, as we go through the points today, I want you to ask yourselves, have I maybe fallen prey to having an open Bible in front of me every morning, every day, every Sunday, but my heart is never open to God's Word? So the first point that I want to say is soothed conscience. A soothed conscience. So, you can open your Bible to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. It has happened to me so many times, and I'm sure you can relate to it. And we justify, or we say that we're doing right, we're in the right place with God because, you know, we're spending our time with Him in the mornings, or I went to witnessing, or I did this, or I did that. And so all you're focusing is on your outward deeds, and somehow that kind of soothes your conscience. But that's the exact thing that Jesus accused the Pharisees of. In Matthew 15, verse 8, He said, "This people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me." So you can see that their heart is closed. Even though these people know the truth, they speak the right things, their heart is closed to the things of God. And so doing religious things will never really work. It's like putting deodorant on, but never showering. And so you go on every day, and you make sure to have that time in the morning where you put your deodorant on. But you never really get to the point where you say, there is something wrong. There is something, why am I doing what I'm doing? What is my motive for what I'm doing? And you never get to the point where you actually take a shower and get right with God. So, the first thing, what will a falsely soothed conscience lead to? And the first thing is complacency. In James chapter 1 and verse 22, we read, "But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was." So here you can see a man who's approaching a mirror, he sees himself, but he goes away unchanged. Now why is this happening? Why is he looking at himself, seeing a problem, and going away unchanged? Well, I want to say it depends on your degree of soothed conscience, but it can be either one of these things. So this guy walks up to the mirror, but he walks up to the mirror like this. So he walks up to the mirror, he's going to the mirror, he has the open Bible in front of him, but he's already made up his mind that he doesn't want to see what is written here. All right. So the first reason you can be complacent towards Christianity, towards God, is because you approach this mirror of God, this open Bible in front of you, with closed eyes. The second reason could be that you blame the mirror for what you're seeing. Okay, you look into this mirror and you see, well, that doesn't look good or something, and then you say, but it must be the mirror. And that is someone who looks at the Bible and sees things that needs to change in his life or her life, but he's like, yo, God's standard is just too high, I'll never attain to that, so I'll rather not try. Another reason why you could be complacent with an open Bible in front of you is because you walk to the mirror, you see the mess, but you're so used to seeing this mess that you've kind of just grown used to it. So every day you walk past the mirror, you see it, you're like, oh, that doesn't look good, and then you go on, all right? And that is someone who has been fed knowledge for so long. He knows, she knows truth, she knows the Bible, but I want to say you've heard it all before. And so you just pass by as if it means nothing. And so if your soothed conscience has led you to this state of complacency, perhaps it's time that you open your heart and not just the Bible, and let His Word rather penetrate, pass through your mind, through the area of knowledge, and hit your heart where so you can do something about it. David said in Psalm 119, verse 11, he said, "Thy Word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against Thee." And so it's that Word of God, that you need an open Bible, there's nothing wrong with it, but it must be hid in your heart, and not just in your mind. And so the second point that I want to speak about is that an open Bible and a closed heart can lead to a substitute. So you substitute God and Jesus for the Bible. And it sounds strange, but if you just spend time in God's Word for that, and not to grow closer to God, and not to actually learn something that you can apply, that you can take out, then what is the point of spending time in His Word? So you substitute the relational side of Christianity for a doctrinal study. And I think that is one other danger of an open Bible but a closed heart. So if Christianity has purely become a study of God's Word, it's purely become prayer, church attendance, that means that you have substituted true Christianity. Because true Christianity is founded on a relationship. It is not church. It is not an event of or a thing of church. It is that God sent His Son to die for sinners, to reconcile us who had no relationship with God, to give us that relationship with God. And so that is Christianity. It is not just a religion. And so think about any friendship. Okay, imagine if here's my friend, and so I decide, I'm rather than spending time with this friend and building a relationship, I'm rather going to say, let me focus on the deeds of the friendship. So let's say, for example, my friend and I, we used to go play temp and bowling. We used to bribe together. We used to do all these things together. So instead of spending this with that friend, I go by myself and I make a bribe and I sit there. And then I have a deep conversation with myself because that's what friends do. And then I go, sad, eh? Oh, okay. And then you go and you go play temp and bowling by yourself. I'm sure Pastor Mike did that sometimes. But the point is, right, it doesn't make that a friendship. If there is no friend, there is no friendship. And so if you're only focusing on the deeds, if you're only focusing on the deeds of Christianity, then where's the relationship with God? Open your Bible to Jeremiah 20. This is a really cool verse. Jeremiah 20. Now, before we read that, knowledge, for the sake of knowledge, is boring. Okay? And I want to say that when you substitute the relationship with God with just a study of His Word, one of two things is going to happen to you. You're either going to get extremely bored with Christianity, or so-called Christianity, or you're going to lack compassion, because if there's no one ever to spend time with to learn to be compassionate towards, how are you going to learn to be compassionate? And the same goes with our walk with the Lord. If we have no relationship, we're going to get bored, and we're going to get, can I say, a lack of compassion. So it becomes exciting as soon as the knowledge hits home, hits your heart, and you start applying it. So I thought of this good illustration because I know my wife loves chocolate cake. And so if you, now imagine the best chocolate cake that you've ever seen, ever thought of, and it's just moist and it's chocolate all over, and it's yeah, I know, we just want to go get a piece of chocolate cake after this. But if you just imagine that chocolate cake and you know and you study it, you know exactly where to get it, right? Which shop, you know how much it costs, you know what the ingredients are, you know the size, you know the, man, you know everything about this cake. And you study it and you keep studying it and you keep studying it. Does that mean anything to you really if you haven't tasted it? I mean, if you don't taste it and you just keep studying the recipe, if you just substitute that actual, the real deal, the real cake for the study of the recipe, what does that actually, it has no effect on you. In fact, someone who has just tasted it, I want to say tasted the cake and seen that it is good, if you got that reference, if you just tasted it, it is so much better than just the boring study of it. So I should probably also page to Jeremiah. Jeremiah 20. And verse 9. Jeremiah 20 and verse 9, it says, now Jeremiah is speaking, he says, Then I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak of in his name, but his word was in mine heart, as a burning fire shut up within my bones. And I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay. And so Jeremiah is saying that This word of God was so real to him that even when he said, okay, I'm going to keep quiet, I'm not going to touch it, I'm not going to have anything to do with it, he could not keep that in. Like, God's word is just, it says that it was forbearing. He couldn't refrain himself from actually doing something about it. Now that, when I read that, that does not sound to me like someone who is bored with what he knows. This is not someone who is bored. He has hid God's word in his heart, and he's looking at this, and he says, I cannot stop myself. Even if I try, I cannot stop myself from doing what God wants me to do. And so I almost want to say, this is a test to ask, to test yourself, to say, am I someone who has just tasted, am I someone who's tasted God, like in his word, in his true form, this relationship, or am I someone who has studied the recipe? Because if you've studied the recipe, I'm pretty sure you'll be able to keep quiet about the recipe. All right? You're not going to share the recipe and like, yeah, here's a piece of the recipe. No. But if you have this cake that is so good, you're going to want to share that. And so that's where Jeremiah was. He said, I could not stay. I could not stay away from the cake. I don't want to draw out this cake illustration too long, but anyways. Why could he not stay away from the cake? Because his heart, it was not just in his head, it was in his heart. So if you have tasted the true relational Christianity, or perhaps if you have not tasted it, or you have forgotten what it tastes like, do something about it. Leave the recipe, or get the ingredients and make the cake and eat it. Don't just sit there, stay there, move on. Now, the second point of a substitution. So the first thing is, you'll get bored, right? You'll just get bored with Christianity because you're just studying a recipe. But if you just keep studying a recipe and you see other people eating this cake, there's something inside you that's going to happen. You're going to grow like, why can't I have that cake? And that's what I'm saying. The next thing that will happen is you will grow a lack of compassion. You grow a lack of compassion when you see people getting excited about God, but all you have is a boring recipe. So the second thing is a lack of compassion. You can open to Mark chapter 3. I think Pharisees are a brilliant example of people who have never tasted cake and have just studied the recipe. And so a lack of compassion comes from an open Bible, but a closed heart when you substitute it. So in Mark chapter 3 and verse 1. So this is Jesus. And he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And they watched him, whether he would heal him. That's not the Pharisees and the scribes. Whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man which hath the withered hand, stand forth. And he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days, or to do evil, to save a life, or to kill? But they held their peace. Excuse me. And when they had looked around about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And so here I see these Pharisees standing there, and you see in verse 2, and they watched him whether he would heal on the Sabbath day. So they knew the law. They knew it was illegal to do a work on the Sabbath day. All right, so they watch it, and they see, they don't see the man with a withered hand and how Jesus can help him. All they see is the law. They see, this is the Bible. No compassion, just this is the Bible. And Jesus is still reaching out to them. You see that in verse 3, and he saith unto them, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath day, or to do evil, to save a life, or to kill? But they held their peace. So Jesus is saying, he's almost giving them a chance to change their mind, to say, okay, maybe we're being a little bit legalistic or whatever, but they just hold their peace. They just give him a blank stare and like, oh, you know what the law says. And then it says, but they've grown so hard in their hearts, in their legalistic Bible studies, that not even the compassion of Jesus giving them a second chance, could move them. Because they just stood there, and after that, they went forth and to accuse him. So Jesus gave them a chance. He gave them a chance to see that they're being overly legalistic. Jesus then has compassion on a man. He shows compassion towards them, but they just hold their peace and they turn away. So God forbid that any of us ever reach that point where we are so used to an open Bible that we do not see the person behind the Bible anymore. But if years of knowledge without heart, so if you just have a recipe without eating, you will end up like these Pharisees. You will end up here where you are just miserable, you're boring, you have no compassion because there is no heart behind it. The third point, I didn't know really what to call this one, but the third one, open Bible but a closed heart, is something, this is not going to fit, something to say. If you have an open Bible but a closed heart, you always just have something to say. In Afrikaans, jy het net 'n appeltjie om te skil. And then you just have a little apple to peel. Listen. Anyway, so you just have an apple to score. In Daniel chapter 5, you can open there. But what I'm trying to say with having something to say is, you know, if I don't know if you've ever felt that way, but You find yourself worrying sometimes so much about sounding educated on a topic, or sounding like you know what our view is supposed to be about a certain doctrinal stance. What are people going to say if you say, well, I haven't studied that yet? Or then you go and you study it, you go study a certain thing, you go read your Bible, just so that next time that topic comes up, that you just don't sound like you don't know anything. But what that all boils down to is you're so concerned about what people think, that you forget the point that what is God looking to do? Why don't you focus on what God wants you to do, what God wants you to study, and glorifying Him through your walk with Him, instead of focusing so much on what the people around you are thinking, and so much about, have you studied this enough? Are you well-versed enough on a certain topic? Because this is nothing else but pride. And Paul warned us about this. Well, he said, comparing yourselves amongst yourself, you are not wise. He also said that knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifies. Right? So knowledge, an open Bible on its own, puffs up. But charity, that love in how you share that Bible, is what edifies. So instead of just starting, I want to say pride is such a big topic, and I think so many people struggle with it. So instead of starting another 5-point sermon on pride, I'd rather just go and read this short piece and show you what the end result and what this pride will do, this desire to always have something to say in the settings that you're in. So in Daniel 5, okay, what happened is Nebuchadnezzar had just died, and Belshazzar, his son, right, is now the king. And so Belshazzar throws this massive party, and he's going and he sends his servants to go fetch the items that were used in the temple, the golden and the silver and the cups and everything, to bring it so that they have more cups to drink wine from. So he's basically taking, I'm going to say, holy ornaments and then using it for shots, you know, to pour shots. That is the disrespect, the pride that he has in his heart to say, I don't think much of God and His things. I'm just going to use that for my pleasure. So he sends his servants, and then God comes in. He steps in the middle of this part, and he writes with his finger on the wall. And Belshazzar wets himself, literally. And his knees start to shake, and he is just afraid. And so he calls for the soothsayers and everyone to come and speak and tell him, what does this writing on the wall mean? And so so Daniel comes, and he tells, when he starts to explain what's written on the wall, he starts by saying, reminding Belshazzar of his father. He starts by telling him, your father was lifted up with pride. And because he was lifted up with pride, God humbled him. And he walked around on his knees, and he was like an animal. And then he came to his senses. Nebuchadnezzar came to his senses. And when he came to his senses, he glorified God. And so now, this is where Daniel comes in. We read from verse 22, speaking to Belshazzar. It says, and thou, his son, O Belshazzar, hast not humbled thine heart, though thou knewest all this, but hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven. And they have brought the vessels of his house before thee, and thou and thy lords, thy wives, and thy concubines have drunk wine in them, and thou hast praised the gods of silver and of gold and brass, iron and wood and stone, which see not, nor hear, nor know, and the God in whose hand thy breath is, and whose are all thy ways, hast thou not glorified. So in verse 22 it says that thou hast not humbled thy heart, though thou knewest all this. So he knew, he had the knowledge, he had the experience, he could go back and see what happened to his father, what pride did to his father, but he didn't learn from it. And then at the end, what happened to him, in verse 30, you read that, and in that night, as Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans slain. And so the end of it was his destruction. Pride brought him to destruction. But what was interesting for me is knowing that he had pride and knowing that his father had a history with it and knowing he could have learned from experience from his father, it still got to him. And so it shows me that there's something about pride that is very deceiving. And so pride is rooted deep down. And this is something that you need to see God for, because from what I see, there are, the solution to this is you seriously humbling yourself. Like in verse 22 said, it says, thou hast not humbled thine heart, or God is going to humble you. And because if you're his child, pride is destructive. And God does not want that in his children. So I think, open your heart and look, do I have pride in there? Is there something that is keeping me away from God? Has my open Bible and my closed heart led me to have a prideful heart? And then do something about it. The fourth and final point is stagnation. Stagnate. Okay, stagnate. An open Bible but a closed heart will lead you to stagnation. Now, stagnate, when I think of stagnation, I think of a pond that has no moving water and it is just cease. Okay? It's just cease. All right? And so, but there are two sides to the stagnation coin. Okay? The one side is towards a saved person and the other side is towards an unsaved person. Now, the first one is an unsaved person that I want to talk about. Stagnation of an unsaved person. You can turn to Luke. Luke chapter 8. So unsaved stagnation. So because an open Bible and a closed heart can soothe your conscience or can give you something to say or substitute a true relationship, the open Bible, closed heart person thinks that they are living a Christian life, although actually it has never started. Because the religious aspect of it gives them a false sense that they are actually living a Christian life. So Luke chapter 8 and verse 13 says, it's talking about the parable of the sower. And they on the rock are they, which when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation, fall away. So the word was received, right? The ground was there, the word was received. Okay, but it's rock. So their heart was so hard to the reading of God's word, to that whatever the pastor said, that the seed did not actually penetrate. It says that it had no root. So the seed actually never germinated. The seed never germinated in that person's heart. So that person is an unsafe person who has now stagnated. They have fallen away. The temptation of the world has just taken over. And so typically an unsafe person who has stagnated say things like this, and I'm sure you've heard this. Something like, I used to be a Christian. Or, I tried Christianity but it didn't work for me. My reaction always towards that is that by default implies that person never really understood true Christianity. Because Christianity is not something you just try. That sounds like a mental decision that you've made, that I'm now going to read Bible, I'm going to try and fix my life, I'm going to go to church. That's what you've done. And I don't even think there's a word for it. That is not Christianity. So there may be someone here or some of you today that has either been there, you've said those things, or you're on your way there, because if you are living a religious life with just doing things, you will end up at this point where you stagnate and just say, well, I tried and it didn't work for me. So if that's your approach, it means your heart is closed and you are busy stagnating. Rather say, open your heart for God's word. Don't let God's word just keep banging there. Open and say, God, teach me, change me, use me, and not just, let me give it a shot. The second one, I said the other side of the stagnation coin is saved stagnation. You can turn to 2 Timothy. Saved stagnation, 2 Timothy 2, 3, I mean. Now, this side of the coin sounds something like this. I'm busy studying God's word, so I can't serve yet. I can't do something yet, right? Now, to my shame, for a large part of my life, this is the type of walk I had with God, if I could call that a walk. I thought because I am still so young in the faith, and because I don't know enough scripture, I can't do anything yet that is of value to God. Well, it's interesting that Saul, when he was met by Jesus on the road to Damascus, that the first thing almost that he said is, "What wilt thou have me to do? What wilt thou have me to do?" from the start. Now, this statement of "I'm studying, so I can't serve" is a statement uttered by someone whose heart's closed. All right? Why? Because if you are truly studying God's word, you will know quickly enough that God's heart is not interested in your degree, in your level of, I'm going to say educatedness, but then I don't sound educated, but anyways. Anyways. So, he's not interested in that, exactly, all right? What he desires is not for you to just blindly study his word. And also, if we just be honest, will you ever truly be done studying God's word? Will there ever be a point where you're like, okay, I have enough now, I'm educated, now I can do something for God? If you're waiting for that, you will stagnate. Because you will just stay there, you'll keep feeding yourself, and someone who keeps feeding themselves physical food and doesn't do anything gets fat. And some people get so fat that they can't stand up. And so if we just stay eating and never doing, that is what will happen. Rather see your doing as part of studying. And when that starts happening, also studying becomes a lot more fun than just sitting there and like theory. But when it actually has a practical application and it can change and do something, that's when it becomes fun. That's when you learn more. So, 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 7. So Paul warns Timothy about this exact thing. It says, ever learning and never able to come to a knowledge of the truth. You can be studying and studying, you can be ever learning and never come to a knowledge of the truth. Because, and this is the trap that so many of us fall for, because it gives us a soothed conscience, makes us think that we are actually accomplishing something. But what is this truth? It says ever learning but never being able to come to a knowledge of the truth. This truth is, if you are saved, right, God wants to use you. Not a year, 2, 3 years. Yes, he'll use you in different ways and in different as you progress in life. But from the day you get saved, God wants to use you. He's got a purpose for your life. So God wants to use you, and that is truth. Another truth is that we have been given a ministry of reconciliation. If you are saved, you understand the gospel. All right? That's pretty basic. And so at least you can share the gospel with someone. As broken as it is, it's better than that person not having heard at all. All right? So you have a ministry of reconciliation. And also, the thing is, remember that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. It's not your intellect. So even if you don't know much, God is the one who saves. God is the one who uses you. It doesn't matter how educated you are. You can know the Bible back to front. But it's still not you saving a person. So it's not about your intellect. So let's stop making excuses for not serving. Because an open Bible without an open heart will result in us ending up stagnant. And that made me think of Jonah. Jonah knew God's word, right? He knew truth. But he had no heart to serve. An open Bible, but no heart, right? And where did he end up? He ended up miserable, angry with God, and sitting under a tree with no leaves. It's just completely stagnant. Because even though he knew truth, and even though he boldly said in the ship that I am a Hebrew, I am a servant of God, of the Most High God, that's knowledge, but there was no action. And so just to clarify though, there's nothing wrong with knowledge, okay? There's nothing wrong with studying God's Word. We are told in 2 Timothy 2 verse 15 that we must study to show ourselves approved unto God, rightly dividing the word of truth. So you must study God's Word. But if you're studying it blindly, your heart is closed and God's Word can't get to you, then what is the point? So the combination of an open Bible with a closed heart is the problem, not the open Bible. Because God is looking for someone who has an open Bible and an open heart who He can use. And so the question today is, are you that person? Have you had enough time? I have an open Bible, but I realize my heart has never been open to God. And so once your heart opens, God can use that open Bible, that study that you've done, use it in your life so that you can make a difference. So in closing, we just want to run through the points again, and that is that an open Bible and a closed heart will soothe your conscience. It will substitute a true living relationship with God. An open Bible and a closed heart will give you something to say in a religious setting to boost your pride. And an open Bible and a closed heart in the end will just result in your stagnation. But there's one thing that I think is more dangerous than an open Bible and a closed heart, and that is both closed. A closed Bible and a closed heart. A closed heart towards the love of God which He has shown to us upon the cross. A closed Bible because of fear that you may discover that God is right, just, and holy, and you are far from that. The Bible says in Romans 3 verse 10 that there is none righteous, not one. It says that we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But then it also says that Jesus was made sin for us. And that even though He knew no sin, so that we can become the righteousness of God in Christ. So you can be righteous and at peace with God. This can only start the day you open your heart to the biblical truth that Jesus came to save sinners and that you are most likely one of them. So I pray that you would open not just your heart, but also your Bible, if you haven't done that, and ask God to speak to you and to use you, because His desire is that every one of us is used by Him and glorifies Him. Amen. Let's stand as we pray. Lord, we come to You, Lord, and we know that our sufficiency is not of ourselves, Lord. And there is no way that we as simple men can glorify You out of ourselves. And may we just put that aside and forget about it and forget about pleasing man, Lord, and let our first priority be pleasing You, Lord. I don't want to grow stagnant. I don't want to just have a soothed conscious thinking I'm doing okay, but Father, my heart is far from You. And I pray that if there's anyone like that here as well today, Lord, that You would please work in them. Help them to see their insufficiency. Help them to see, Lord, where they need You, Father. Father, we need You more than I think we ever know. And Father, I ask that You would please guide us. Please help us to take this message and not just store it in our minds and maybe even forget it tomorrow, Lord, but let it pass through, let it penetrate our hearts, and let it make a change. A change for You, a change for Your kingdom, a change for Your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
You keep your head eyes closed, you can remain standing. Caleb, if you do something quietly, just for a few minutes. Yeah, I want you folks just to take a minute or two more in an attitude of prayer and let this sink past your mind. Let it sink down into the heart. Let the Word of God reach deep down. Find out how it applies to you personally. That was an outstanding message of balance. outstanding message of balance. I love how he summed it up. You need both. Open Bible, open heart. Folks, he didn't say close your Bible and open your heart. Right? It's not just live it how you feel it. Open your Bible. Open your heart. Well, how encouraging that is. Isn't that something that God can use us despite our lack of knowledge? He gave you the verse, knowledge puffeth up, charity edifieth. If any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know, it says. Because if you know it just to know it, you don't know it for the right reason. So you know nothing yet as you ought to know. What does it mean, ought to know? Why should you know things? The next verse says, if any man love God, the same is known of him. You know things, you learn things, so that you can love God, serve God better. There's the balance. What a great message today to explain that. Just take another few moments in prayer. I want you to examine your heart, but if you're here and you've never been saved, you have heard today that Jesus came and took your place. He told you at the end. That sinner, you can be saved. You can be forgiven. The righteousness of God is available for you. You have to open your heart and let Jesus come in. Now, if you've never done that, I'm not going to point you out, but I'd like to pray for you. If you've never done that, you've never let the Lord Jesus Christ come in and save you, would you just slip your hand up and put it right back down? Would anybody be honest enough to say that? Preacher, thank you. I see that hand. Wonderful. Anybody else say, preacher, pray for me? I appreciate that honesty. Christians, I'm going to ask you one thing before I pray. How many of you today, as he was preaching that thing, realize that it's only getting to my head and my heart's been closed for a while? Anybody like that? Would you just acknowledge that? Say, I've been doing it by habit. It's all in my head. I know I should do it, but boy, my heart has been far from it. I appreciate the honesty. Father, we've prayed already. I just want to end this service by asking for your help and a couple of things. There was a hand that went up. Somebody wants to be saved. God, save that soul, please. Speak to that person's heart, not just the head, but the heart. Might it be real for that person today? And might today be the day of that one's salvation? And Lord, so many hands went up. It's so difficult for us to keep the heart open. God, would you please help us to keep that soft, open heart? Thank you so much for the open Bible. Thank you for opening our understanding to it. Lord, we want more than that. Please, God, continue to use us as we continue to learn. Father, would you please dismiss us now with your blessing? Bring us back tonight hungry, as Brother Garrett said, for some more cake. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, folks, have a wonderful afternoon. I'm going to go home and eat cake. Amen.